Tell me where you were born, where you grew up.
In West Jefferson, North Carolina, a Tar Heel, September the 18th, 1919.
Was it a small town upbringing you had, or?
Well, I was country. I was born over the Paddy Mountain from West Jefferson. In fact, there was mountains on four sides of where I was born. So when you talk about hillbilly, I know who you're talking about.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Not really. Nobody had any money, and everybody was poor, and nobody realized it. That's what it was.
Because it was a farm, did you have plenty of food, though?
Oh, yeah, we had plenty of food now, but that was just starting out. We moved into town in 1928, I guess it was, so.
Why did you move into town?
Well, my daddy was a country preacher, Baptist preacher, and he pastored five different churches at the same time. Some of them, it catch on every other Sunday on the morning, and some of them every other Sunday in the afternoon, and some of them at night, whatever. But that's how we ended up in Virginia. That was his first pastorate, and that was 1924 or 1925, I can't remember which it was.
What was it like being the son of a preacher?
Everybody picked on me. There's that preacher's kids, that's the meanest little devil in the neighborhood.
were you the kind of kid that liked school?
I liked it all, but some of the studying I didn't care that much for, but I enjoyed school, yes. I had fun.
And tell me about your mother. You told me about your father. Tell me about your mother. Was she a good cook? That kind of.
Oh, yes, yes.
Was she a good mother?
Oh, yes. And she could knock a knot on your head, too, in a hurry. She was a big woman. She was 5 feet. Let's see, my daddy was 5'10", and she was 5'9¾". He's a quarter of an inch taller than her. And she weighed about 200 pounds, so you didn't argue with her. So she was a good old country girl. She only had like a sixth grade education. Her mother got real sick, and she had to go home and take care of the brothers and sisters. And the fact is, she raised her brothers and sisters. She was the oldest child. But she was a good old gal. But just don't mess with her.
What was your situation when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
Believe it or not, I was already a married man. And I was at my wife's house, and we'd had a big lunch. I went back and sat down by the old Motorola radio. It had one of those little eyes that closed up when you tuned it real good. And my father-in-law was up by the fireplace telling some wild tale. And I turned the radio all down fairly low, and I heard all this going on. I turned up a little bit, and I told Daddy Baker, I said, "Be quiet a minute, something's going on here." And he was talking about Pearl Harbor had been bombed. So that was it, and I knew good and well that here I go, huh?
You knew you were going to get called up.
Oh, yeah.
Well, talk about the process under which then that you got into the Army Air Corps. How did you get in?
Just lucky, I guess. I don't know. When I got my draft call, my first child, my baby, was 3 weeks old when I left. She was born 19, as my daughter's downstairs with me, she's born 1943, on March the 12th, and I got my call March the 20th. So off to the big war I went, and left a wife and a brand new baby there. So that was hard, but it wasn't as bad as some of the guys. Because when I finished, I was drafted into Camp Lee, Virginia, and from that to Keesler Field, Mississippi, for basic training. Well, somewhere along during that basic training, they gave you a bunch of tests to take, and I had a big long sheet of paper, had 50 numbers on it, and had yes and no. And they sent code. If it sounds like, check yes. And sent in groups of twos. And if it doesn't sound like, check no. So I made a good grade on that. Somebody told me any time of test they give you, do the best you can, that'll help you get a raise in your rank. So about 5 weeks into basic training, I got a note on the bed one day to report to somebody at the orderly room. So I went over there and he's drumming his pencil on the desk, a little PFC, you know, and said, Hodgson, said, what do you want to be in this man's army? And I said, well, the first thing, I said, I have been a bookkeeper, so I could work in the office. I said, the second thing, I have been a clothing salesman, so I could fit clothing like that. And I said, third thing, I don't care, truck driver, whatever you got. And he drummed that pencil a little bit more, said, well, you're going to be a radio operator. I said, I don't want to be a radio operator. He said, well, you're going to be. I said, well, why did you waste your time and my time asking me all these questions when you knew when I walked in here what it's going to be? He said, well, that's routine. We have to do it. So they packed me up and shipped me from there to Sioux Falls, South Dakota. The good thing about that part was I missed a 25-mile hike. I didn't have to take that. So Sioux Falls, South Dakota, I got there in April, and there was still a little bit of snow on the ground in the shady places. But that was the best town I was in as far as the people were concerned.
Talk about the training then you had to go through.
Well, let's see, I did my basic in Keyserville, Mississippi, and then there I did my radio school in Sioux Falls. And then after that, I went to, Yuma, Arizona for gunnery school. So they had me all over the whole United States. So that's, I got to see it mostly from a train when the biggest majority of it.
So you went through the training process. You know, during the training process, did anything unusual happen, mishaps, anything stand out in your mind?
One time when we got to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, they told us now, they made us, well, they asked you to sign a piece of paper saying, I will not bring my wife here to live if you're married. So I signed one of those things, and I got to thinking, that's none of their business where my wife lives. So I tore it up and threw it away. So I found a room with a bedroom that we could use a hot plate in, and got wife and the little baby was 3 months old at that time, and brought them up there. And so she stayed there till I finished school. It was about 5 months that she stayed there. Then that's when I shipped out to Yuma, Arizona to gunnery school. And of course she couldn't go. I didn't want her down there anyhow. Couldn't find a place. So I was there. I was there till just right around Christmas time is when I shipped out of Yuma. Got a delay en route home and back to Ardmore, Oklahoma. That was my final spot. And we got in the place, and the guy's giving us all this information. He said, what position do you fly? I said, I'm a radio operator. He said, oh, hell, there's more of them getting killed than any other position. I said, thank you, pal. But it was the whole thing, it was interesting.
And what was happening there? Was there some point a crew came together?
Oh yeah, yeah. Fact is, my crew, they assign a crew in Salt Lake City. Well, the crew I was on, I got sick on the train going from Salt Lake City to Ardmore, Oklahoma, and I was in the hospital for a month. I was in the hospital 30 days and lost 29 pounds. I couldn't eat. It was that part of it was horrible. So I got out, I found they shipped the crew in minus a radio operator. So I was in what they call the combat pool there at Ardmore, and then they assigned me to my crew. So O'Connor was their pilot. He was barely short enough to get in. He was 6'4¾" or something, but he was a good pilot.
Talk about how the crew came together. Did all the guys get along and that kind of
thing?
Yeah,
all except we had he was our navigator, Jewish fella from up New York. He was, he didn't fit in too well with the rest of them for some reason. I don't know what. The pilot finally had him taken off the crew, And the irony of that was, they left him in the same barracks he was in and put him on the other crew that was in there. So, and two missions after that, he got shot down. But he and the pilot were the only two that got out of it. And he weighed about, his normal weight was about 180 or 85 pounds. And he became a German prisoner. You know how Germans hate the Jewish people. So he got back to our base just before we shipped out coming home. He weighed 220 pounds. I said, boys, does that tell you anything? I said, I bet he told them anything they wanted to know and a little bit more, too.
When the crew came together and you're still in the training phase,
yeah.
Did your wife come move with you when you were in that part of it?
Yeah, she. I got a place for her in Ardmore, Oklahoma, so that I could spend the nights at home there, as long as I caught that bus to be at the base next morning at 7 o'clock. So, but that worked out real well.
Did your wife meet the other guys on the crew?
Oh yeah, she was kind of the den mother, so to speak. I was the only married man on the crew, and the boys would come out on their day off during the week, and they'd buy steaks, great big steaks, come out and she'd fry the steaks for us, and they'd bring watermelons and all that stuff, and they spoiled them. My daughter's with me here now, 63 years old. She was like 22 months old, and they spoiled the whiz out of her. So it was interesting.
Talk about going over to Europe. How did that happen?
Well, all our training we got through, we ended up at Lincoln, Nebraska. And they told us, now, don't leave the base. Come into the order room checking first, because you're on alert. You could be called to go any time. So we hung around there and we could go to the movie, and that's as much as we could do. So we hung around there, and in about a week's time, we got that call. And off we went. They gave us a brand new B-17, nice shiny thing, and on the bulkhead between my radio room and the bomb bay was written all these girls' names that had worked on that airplane at Lockheed, names and address. And so the boys on the crew, the single man, got copied and wrote letters to them for a while. So that's how we got that airplane. We flew right by the lower end of lake something up there, across up, and landed in Bangor, Maine. That's where we landed. And we took off from there and went to Goose Bay Lab. No, let's see, we landed in, what was the next thing? Wasn't Goose Bay? Yeah, it was Goose Bay Labrador. We landed there. Then we flew to Iceland. And we almost got stuck there. There was a big front coming in. If we didn't get off the ground by 10 o'clock or whatever it was, so we had to be there about a week. So we just barely made it. We got off and we flew to England. And I had to keep a log of everything that was sent and that I was sending on the radio and all that. And somewhere along the way, we had a flimsy sheet, and the code changed every hour. I think it changed every half an hour. So when we got fairly close enough to Scotland, we was going to land in Scotland, I was supposed to call in and tell them what our approximate landing time would be, and all that the pilot would tell me. I'd do it on the code, you know.
This is all Morse code?
Morse code, uh-huh. Yeah. And so we got along, and I could hear their signal, but it was pretty faint. And I figured, well, I better wait till I get a little closer so they could be sure and pick me up. So we got till I could hear them pretty good, and I got on that key and started sending INTQDM. That's the cue signal for what direction do I fly to reach you. And so we got back, the answer on that thing was three letters, and I looked it up on the code sheet, and it didn't make sense. And I sent it again, and I got a different number that time, a different numbers and letters. And I told the pilot, I said, something's wrong here. I said, I'm picking up a stronger signal than I was getting from there. He said, stay off that radio. The German submarines were out there saying what they would do. They'd try to give you the directions to fly. They'd surface and shoot them down. They shot down a few like that. So after a while, they kept sending da-di-da, K. That means go ahead. And I just maintained radio silence. And pretty soon, they had on their copy of the code said, fly so many degrees, whatever it was. And I asked a navigator, I said, if we fly that degree, I said, where are we going? He said, straight to the North Pole. And I told him what it was. He said, well, they're trying to get us up there somewhere where they can blast us out. So, but they kept going back there, Dottie Dog, go ahead, go ahead.
But you ended up landing safely
then. Oh, yeah, yeah. And we never saw that airplane again. We thought, oh, boy, this is our nice, beautiful airplane and all that stuff. But they modified them, added stuff, took stuff off and all that stuff.
What was the base like?
Way out in the country. The fact is, it was right in the middle of a farm. Big farm country. And they're the nicest old English gentleman around there that you ever saw. That you give them a cigarette or whatever, their way of, instead of saying thank you, there's ta, and many ta's. But they were great. They were very good.
What was it like living on the base? You lived in Quonset huts?
Yes.
What was that like?
Well, blackout, it was kind of hectic at times, but we had a good bunch in our, you only had 18 men in a hut. So we did well with that. We didn't have any bad eggs in it. We had one we had to take overseas with us, and the pilot got rid of him as soon as we got there, because he'd been in the guardhouse like 14 out of the 20 months he'd been in service, and they made us take him. Our tailor gunner got sick just before we left, and they put him on there against the pile. So we got over the, and thank goodness they'd cut the crew from 10 to 9. So that's a good way to get rid of him. So, and he hung around there and fooled around a while and mooched cigarettes. I bet I've given him a carton, just a pack at a time. And finally, one day came and he said, boys, I'm going to get the fly tomorrow. And they was going to let him fly on a mission. And dang if he didn't get shot down on the first mission. It was sad. He didn't have any background whatsoever.
Were you checked out and once you got there? Was there further training and checkout when you arrived?
Yeah, we had to do some practice flying. So many takeoffs and so many landings, and I had to do so many different things on the radio and stuff like that. So, but it was interesting.
On a mission, what would a radio man do? Give me a job description. Once you're in the air, what you do on a mission?
I had to stay on that, keep those headsets on at all times, except if I go to man a gun. If I had to go man a gun, like I had to write that on my log. Anything that came over that radio, I had to have it on my log when I got back, or you really got chewed out as well. So,
who would be sending a signal then that you would pick up if you're on a mission?
Our base back at England, and we could reach them, and there was three radios on that B-17. One of them, one went from bomber to bomber, one from bomber to ground, and one from bomber to fighter plane. So that was what it was.
And how would you man all three radios?
Two of them, you just left them turned on, and they did their own thing. And I handled my ass. I can tell you the number of it right now, SCR-287. And SCR stands for Signal Corps Radio. That's what, it's funny little things that you remember.
What would be typical messages that would come through on a mission?
Well, now they didn't send us much of anything unless the weather was going to be bad. The weather's going to be bad. In fact, they called us back one time because England was closing in. In fact, we had to fly all the way across England to land at a Navy base at Liverpool, right below Liverpool.
How many missions did you fly?
35.
And in those 35 missions, are there some missions that stand out in your mind?
Oh, yes.
Tell us about some of the missions that stand out in your mind.
The worst one was November the 30th, 1944. That was Merseburg. That was the biggest synthetic oil factory that Germany had. And we're supposed to bomb, go south of it and go straight across it. It was about 3 miles long and about a mile wide. That's how big that thing was. It was huge. And we're supposed to go across the narrow way and get bombed. So the lead navigator, whoever was on the lead ship, had miscalculated the tailwinds was stronger than they thought for. And we missed that IP, which is the initial point. That's where you turn to go on your bomb run. And so we went on beyond. Instead of getting out away from everything, they did a 360-degree turn, and we got the flak, that's the aircraft gun, from Leipzig and Zeitz and all the way back up Merseburg. We were in flak for 35 minutes. And well, we lost 55 B-17s that day, the Air Force did. And our group lost the most that day. Our field lost the most that day that they lost on any mission during the war.
Was your plane getting hit by flak?
260-some holes I counted when I got back. And on the left wing, there's a I-beam that goes out through that wing, out through there. And that thing was shot half in two. It looked like you'd taken a biscuit cutter and cut half. And I don't know how that wing stayed on there, but somebody was looking after us, I'll tell you. But they had to remake that whole, it had patches on it. They patched all those flak holes, the little ones, and they had to put some new stuff in all over it. We were down for about 2 weeks after that.
Were there other missions that stood out in your mind?
Well, my first one stands out too, my very first mission. The CQ forgot to wake us up. The enlisted men live in one part of the squadron, the officers live in another. And so all of a sudden, about 5 o'clock in the morning, the CQ comes tearing in our hut, says, "Come on, O'Connor's crew, you're flying, let's go." Said, "We forgot to wake you." And so I told the old guy, I said, "Let's go by the mess hall." He said, don't have time. I said, "Listen, this is my first mission and it could be my last one. And I'm not gonna leave here on an empty stomach." So got there, and he said, "Well, run in there right quick." So we jumped in and grabbed us a piece of that old brown bread and a little jelly or something and a little thing of milk. Now there we went and didn't get to go to briefing, didn't know the radio operator has what you call a flimsy, onion skin sheet of paper. It has the call signals and the frequencies for that day. It didn't have that. They took us straight to the airplane. The engines are already revved up, ready to go. They were waiting on us to get there, take off. So we got in the airplane and one of the funny things that happened, we started climbing to altitude. And we probably climbed about 20,000 feet over England before you take off. And so we was going along, and the co-pilot, I got the thing on my intercoms, radio operator from co-pilot. I said, "Go ahead, sir." He said, "Nervous?" And I said, "Yes, sir, are you?" He said, "You trying to be a damn smart aleck?" I said, "No, sir, maybe I didn't understand you. I thought you asked me if I was trying to be a smart aleck, but I'm not." And the pilot chimed in and said he didn't get the briefing this morning. He doesn't know that's the code word to turn on the carpet. Was what that piece of radio equipment was, they called the carpet. And the code word was, that's what the code word was. And he said, "Okay, now when I say relax, don't lay down and go to sleep, that means cut the dang thing off." So that was first mission. It was to Hamburg. Hamburg.
Was there ever occasion that you had to transmit when you're on a mission? That is, was being on the radio strictly listening?
Yeah. Oh, well, most of the time now. There was a couple of times I had to get us back. I was telling you about that navigator we had. It was a a little bit on the shaky side. I could get us back. I could reel out the, we had what you called a trailing wire antenna. It had a great big lead ball about that big, so it'd straighten it out behind the airplane. I guess that antenna was probably 200 feet long or something. And it'd carry a signal a whole lot further than the little fixed antenna on top of the airplane. So a few times I had to use that thing and getting us back. So one time pilot told me to call RC Rescue. That day we got shot up so bad that lost some gasoline and all that stuff. So he said, call RC Rescue and give them our approximate time coming in. He told me what it would be, so they can shoot a fix on us and tell us exactly where we are. And they have what they call little slave stations along the line, and each one of them send out, and where those lines cross, that's where you are. And they could, even back that far back, they could pinpoint you pretty well. So we got back and got just barely across the English Channel, and that big old rocks thing over there, they had, English had a lot of
barrage balloons?
Barrage balloons, that's what it was, with those big steel cables. And we just barely got over some of those things. And of course, we didn't have two engines, with two of them shot out. And we sat down on the runway, and the pilot called, said, I'm coming in for immediate landing. And they said, go around. He said, I can't go around. I don't have enough gasoline if I make it this far. So we set that airplane down, and by the time he rolled up, bit one of the engines spit, and the other three engines were gone in. So that was the worst. And our top turret gunner was a Polish boy from Toledo, Ohio. And so when you have wounded aboard, that's when our tail gunner got hit. You fire a red flare. So old Belosky fired all the red flares we had, and he'd take all the flares, red and green, or red and yellow. The control tower said, get that idiot off that very pistol, said he's going to burn the base up. And old Blosky said, well, dang, old Bill was hurt, and I wondered what that was for. They have an ambulance out there, and that ambulance come up beside the runway over in the grass, and he'd follow you after you got on the ground. He'd follow you to your hard stand where you parked the airplane. And that's only the old Bill guy. But he stayed in the hospital for over a year. And learning a little something about it, he decided, by golly, he believed he's just going to go to med school. And he went to med school and made a good pediatrician. He retired about 4 or 5 years ago. And so that paid off for him in a way.
Were there any missions that you had to man the guns?
I had to go back and man a waste gun. We had originally had a gun right in the radio room, but it wasn't worth anything except somebody flying directly over the top of you. And a lot of them, that big horizontal staple out, a lot of guys would shoot that thing off their own airplane sometime because it didn't have a cutoff cam on it. But I had to go back and man a waste gun. Let's see, it was on Christmas Day of 44. We had a mission. It's the first time that one of the German jets had gotten after us. Most of them had been the Focke-Wulf 190s and Messerschmitt 109, ME-109 and FW-1. And this thing was ME-262, was a twin-engine jet. But he was a rookie pilot, and he got right on the same level as we were, and all that prop wash of the B-17s, you could see him back there just tossing him around just like a leaf in a hailstorm. And he was firing those 20 millimeter cannons, and we had 50 calibers, the biggest thing we had, and our 50 calibers wouldn't reach back that far. Well, far we know, we never did hit him, and he never did hit anybody. So, but that was a heck of a way to spend the Christmas Day. But that was a lot of funny things that happened.
Were you conscious of a countdown to your last mission?
Oh, yes, definitely. Fact is, that last one, the CQ called Says, came in our barracks, said, "Oh, Connor, screw you, you're flying tomorrow." And we said, "Yeah, we know it." He said, "Okay." The CQ said, "Be in bed by 8 o'clock." Well, they never told us that before. And somebody got the rumor started. That's when they were flying those shuttle missions to Russia and back. You flying three different missions all together. And so everybody fussing, "They can't do that to us. We've only got one to go. They can't do that." And we was trying to find out all that. So we got up and we went to briefing next morning. And we had a intelligence officer. He looked like Joe E. Brown. Big old ugly rascal, but he was smart. And every time he briefed us, it was a rough mission. You got this black curtain. I don't know why it has to be black, but over the map and the route you're going out, and you have a red ribbon going to the target and a black one coming back. Well, he got up and he pulled that back, and you could see that thing a little ways, and he turned around and looked at us and grinned, that old mean grin, you know, and he yanked it open, and it only went about that far. It went just barely across the channel, across the Zuider Zee, and we bombed a airfield in Belgium that the Germans had been using to come over to drop a bomb on us. So that was my last mission.
So it was an easy mission then?
Then we were back on the ground at 10-something that morning. And they gassed up the airplane, loaded up with bombs. They flew three missions that day. I forget how many airplanes that they had up that day. It was a few thousand, though, counting all the different fields that flew together.
How did it feel after that last mission? And did the crew celebrate?
Did they ever? Yeah, the pilot had us down there. I was not a drinking man. I'm thinking. Pilot had us down to their hut, and he gave us, and gave me a big snort or something. Boy, I tried to ride my bicycle back up to my hut, and I couldn't do it. I was all over that place. So, yeah, that was the end of it.
And so, what happened? Where did you go, or what happened after that?
Well, the officers all came home, but they had passed a new directive just about 2 weeks before that. That all enlisted men had to stay and help the ground crews. See, the ground crews had been over there 20-some months, most of them already. And to let a few of them get back home, we had to stay and help them. I went up to the orderly room and told them about before I flew that last mission. I said, "Now, we're going to have to stay a while." And I said, "If you got anything around here I can do to get through." And old Sergeant Fullwater looked like Bim Gump. He was a newspaper man from Chicago. He said, "Can you type?" I said, "I sure can." He said, "Okay." He said, you finish your missions and rest up a week and come in here. I'll get you a job." So the ball turret gunner and top turret gunner said, "Why, you brown-nosing son of a gun, you." And I said, "Well, just wait." They had the get out and go load the gas, fill it up, the plane with gas, and help load the bombs. And they had to get up 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning. And I said, "Boys, please don't wake me as you go." Then they called me a nice name or two. But it was good. It was a good crew. The enlisted boys got along fine.
And so did you finish off doing the office work? What were you doing when VE Day occurred?
I was dodging bullets most of the time. Some of them crazy people, some of those crazy guys over there was firing caliber 50 somewhere up through the woods where our hut was. And you could hear that thing ricocheting off of different things. They weren't trying to hit anybody, they're fine. But that's what I had to stay there till, let's see. Oh, that's... And the guys got those very pistols out. They was, they lit the sky up with all those other than the tannoy system and say, "There'll be no more flares fired on this base tonight." About that time, they were going everywhere. And the ones that could drink and had it, they was getting drunker by the minute. So, so that was it. After we finally got finished up there, I went to Stone, England. That's where where the assignment's going in, that's where the assignment's coming out. So we laid around there for about 2 weeks, I guess. And then we thought we was going to get to fly home. And they said, no, we're going to fly the ground troops. They said, y'all had all the flying, and said they hadn't had any. So we were down, and we figured we were going to catch one of those tugboats kind of like that. But we got the Queen Mary. That was some ship, buddy. We got in a storm out there on the way back, and you could see that flowing in, going way down, looked like it's going right down in the water, and then come back up again. But it was so big, you couldn't get seasick. I don't think anybody got seasick on it. So we had that storm and that fog, and big fog in the way, and that old captain get on that, that old fog horn, and about every minute or two, he's driving you crazy. And finally, he said, boys, we're going to open it up. And he that thing we was doing about 35 knots, something like that. I guess it actually went about 35 miles an hour, something like that. So we blasted right on through that fog and without any incident. But it was a good trip home.
And where did you meet up with your wife then eventually?
After I got out, at home.
Yeah.
I got home at, let's see, what I had to travel. Then I got home at 7 o'clock in the morning, and went up to the bedroom and gave her a big kiss on the cheek, and she was, she started screaming. She knew I was coming, but she didn't know exactly when. See, one thing I would do, try to let her know how many missions I had. I would write to her and tell her. I told her, anything that I give you a crazy bunch of numbers, well, that's how many missions I've got. So I told her one time I was surprised to hear old Daisy May had 23 pups. Daisy May was our bulldog. That was my 23rd mission. You can add a few little things in there and get away with it.
When you look back on that time, what do you think about now when you look back?
How lucky I was.
Are you proud of your time in service?
Oh, yes, sir.
Why is that?
I don't know. I feel like I've done my duty to protect the nation. I mean, that's kind of the way I look at it. But I felt like I was fighting that war for her family and my family and everybody else. I mean, it's just... I knew it was my duty, and I hated to leave a wife and baby and get over there, but that was it.